Hey guys, welcome to another video from Foolish Engineer. This time we'll check out the working of a chip converter with waveforms, its advantages, disadvantages, and applications. So let's go for a ride. The chip converter is named after Dr. Slobodan Chuk, the inventor of chip converter. It is made of a MOSFET, or we can say an active switch, a diode, two inductors, and three capacitors. The construction of the converter is like this. The PWM pulses are given to the MOSFET, which switches the MOSFET on and off, and that's how the output voltage is adjusted. At the output, we get the inverting voltage. That means if the positive voltage is given at the input, then the output voltage will be of negative value. This inverting output voltage is either higher or lower than the input voltage depending upon the duty cycle of the PWM given to the MOSFET. This section looks like the boost converter topology. And this section is identical to the buck converter, but it is connected in inverting direction. And both of these converters are coupled with an energy storage capacitor. The formula of output voltage of the chip converter is given like this, where D is the duty cycle of the PWM given to the MOSFET. A negative sign shows that the output voltage is inverting. So at the input, a DC supply has to be given. Initially, everything is still. Nobody charged, nobody is supplying power to anyone. But when the MOSFET is turned on, this inductor starts charging. In the starting phase, it opposes the flow of current. Basically, it acts as the high resistance component. But after some time, its impedance decreases and current starts rising. Now, the MOSFET is turned off. Due to sudden drop in current, the polarity of the inductor reverses and it induces the flyback voltage, which has the magnitude of V is equal to LdI by dt, where L is the inductance of the inductor and di by dt is the change in current with respect to time. The voltage which has been induced across the inductor is in the same direction as the input voltage, so the additional voltage has been added. Due to that, the current tries to flow and complete the circuit. So, this capacitor starts charging by this inductor. Wait a minute. The voltage on this inductor is DC. So, how does this capacitor let the current flow? Well, the current which is provided by this inductor is not constant DC. It is decreasing continuously. So, this capacitor acts as the short circuit and the diode D1 gets forward biased. During these both cycles, there is no output power provided to the load. Now the MOSFET is turned on again. The inductor L1 starts charging. As the capacitor C1 is already charged, this capacitor starts discharging through this path and it provides power to the load. Simultaneously, L2 stores the energy provided by the capacitor C1. Now the MOSFET is turned off again. As the inductor L1 is charged, it tries to charge the capacitor C1. The inductor L2 is also charged. It induces the flyback voltage, so the L2 starts providing power to the load. And this is how a chip converter works. Let's understand the working of this converter more thoroughly with the waveforms. So initially, the PWM is given to the MOSFET. Let's consider this is an N-channel MOSFET. When the gate pulse is high, this MOSFET turns on. The current across inductor starts increasing linearly. Due to this inductor L1, the current starts increasing through the MOSFET as well. As the MOSFET is on, the voltage across MOSFET is zero. Now, this side of the circuit is totally isolated and there is no current flowing through this part. So the capacitor C1 current, inductor current L2 and the output voltage are zero. In the second stage, the MOSFET is turned off, so there is no current flowing through this circuit. As the input is cut off, the inductor starts charging the capacitor C1, so its current decreases linearly. So due to this, the voltage across MOSFET will be equal to the input voltage plus the flyback voltage generated by the inductor. Now the diode is turned on because it gets forward biased, and the capacitor starts charging, so the current flowing through the capacitor is equal to the inductor current L1. Even in this stage, the current doesn't flow through the output side of the converter, so the inductor current L2 and the output voltage is zero. Now the MOSFET is turned on again in the third cycle. The current of the inductor starts increasing and stores energy. And through the same MOSFET, the current flows from the capacitor C1 and it starts discharging. So the current across MOSFET increases. This time the current across MOSFET is the addition of the inductor current L1 and L2. Because during this time, both inductors are charging simultaneously. The voltage across MOSFET is zero. Now when the capacitor is discharging, the voltage provided by the capacitor is equal to the output voltage. And if you check the polarity of the flow of current, then we can clearly say that the output voltage is inverting. Due to capacitor C1, the inductor L2 charges, so the current across inductor increases. So this time, we get the constant DC output voltage. Now, in the fourth cycle, the MOSFET is turned off. The current across inductor starts decreasing and it charges the capacitor. And there is no current flowing through the MOSFET. The voltage across MOSFET will be equal to the input voltage plus flyback voltage of the inductor L1. The diode turns on. The capacitor current is equal to the inductor current L1. So this part of the circuit behaves just like the second cycle. But inductor L2 comes into the picture. It induces the flyback voltage. So the power to the load is provided by the inductor L2 and output capacitor. Because these components had stored the energy and charge in the earlier cycle of the converter, and the inductor current L2 decreases linearly, which keeps the output voltage constant. So this third and fourth cycle repeats throughout the process and we get the regulated inverting output voltage. In easier words, when the MOSFET is on, the inductor L1 and L2 stores the energy from the input and series capacitor respectively. When the MOSFET is off, these inductors release the stored energy, so L1 charges the series capacitor and L2 provides the output power. And this is how a tube converter works. This DC to DC converter circuit can be used as a power factor correction circuit. It can also be used in the maximum power point tracking of a solar panel, just like we use a buck boost converter. There are several advantages of this converter. The tube converter has a very good EMI/EMC results. Every switching circuit creates the electromagnetic interference. In the tube converter, both input and output currents are filtered by the LC filters. They reduce the electromagnetic interference generated by the circuit and make the electromagnetic compatibility of the converter very simple. The tube converter has very low ripple currents, as the currents in the both inductors are of same value. So they can share a common core, which simplifies the construction and helps to reduce the ripple current. These type of inductors are known as coupled inductors. Third is the efficiency. This design is also very efficient because the capacitor charge and discharge through inductors, which minimizes the high current spikes. The MOSFET Q1 is a low side switch, so it becomes very easy to drive this MOSFET through simple low side drivers. The biggest disadvantage of this Chewk converter is that it is very dependent on this capacitor C1. All of the current flowing from the input to output has to go through this capacitor, and this capacitor must be non-polarized because the voltage across it reverses with each half cycle. In high power applications, we generally need high value capacitance, so we cannot use the Chewk converter for high powers. The design of the control loop should be very stringent to achieve the stable operation, because there are four reactive components which might create the resonance in the circuit, and controlling gets very difficult. So that's it for the Chewk converter. I hope you understood something from this. If you have any questions, let me know in the comment section. Hit the like button if you like this video. Subscribe to my channel. And finally, thanks for watching.